Hi, I'm Lynette Pearson, and this is the Video Voters Guide, a service of the League of Women Voters, a 102-year-old nonpartisan organization that believes democracy depends on informed and active participation. For more election information, be sure to visit our website, vote411.org, before you mark your ballot. Today, we welcome Kurt Schrader, candidate for U.S. Representative District 5. Welcome, Kurt.
Hey, thanks, Lynette. Thanks for League of Women Voters for putting this forum on. I always find them, and hopefully voters do too, very educational.
Thank you very much for being here. First off, tell us a little bit about yourself, and what are your top three issues in running for this position?
Well, I'm the current congressman for the 5th Congressional District, formerly representing or currently representing the Willamette Valley and Central Oregon Coast. Soon to represent some southeast, southwest Portland, Clackamas County, Linn County, eastern Marion County, and northern Deschutes County. I've been a long-term resident of the district, lived here 45 years, raised my family, five children in Canby, Oregon, just south Oregon City. Started my own veterinary clinic in Oregon City 30-plus years ago. Great experience. I did enjoy going to work every day as a veterinarian, at least. I also have a small farm down here in Canby where we grow organic fruit or have grown organic fruits and vegetables, sheep, and then spend a stint in the Oregon State Legislature. You could do that part-time and still keep your business going. So I was in the House of Representatives, the Oregon State Capitol in Salem for 6 years, and then again another 6 years as a senator. I was in charge of the budget for the state of Oregon. Darlene Hooley retired from her seat in Congress, and I ran and won back in 2008. Got inaugurated along with Barack Obama, so to speak, and been in Congress ever since. Proud of the work we've done in helping our country get through one of the darkest times with COVID. Very, very excited about the infrastructure package, bipartisan infrastructure package that the president helped put together that will help hopefully set up a much better tone for our recovery over the next decade or so. So that's going to be important, making sure the jobs roll out the way we're expecting. Great to see the job market being as open as it is right now. Wages going up, pretty excited about that. Got to get that inflation under control. That's going to be a priority. The climate change is real. We've seen it here in Oregon with the wildfires. I've helped lead the charge on getting that under control. I've got a bill in Congress, bipartisan bill, to address climate change. Of course, I've worked with Senator Wyden and some of our colleagues in Idaho to build a disaster relief fund and do some vegetative management, some project management in the woods to curtail these horrible fires. Healthcare is another top issue. I was there when we started the Affordable Care Act back in 2010, great opportunity to begin the discussion about universal access to affordable health care. Still working on that, some work to do, and the Build Back Better bill that I voted for at the end of last year. Hopefully the Senate, with a little urging from us, will take some of these key elements up this current year. And in that same bill, I worked really hard to come up with a prescription drug plan that would reduce prices dramatically, allow Medicare to negotiate drug prices, very important. Making sure drug prices don't increase above the rate of inflation. And the biggest one, perhaps, is keeping out-of-pocket costs to seniors at just $2,000 a year. That'd be transformational. I talked to folks and had a guy at a town hall the other day. It was like $400 a month for him. This would be huge for him. So those are our top priorities.
Oh, thank you very much. As you mentioned climate change, it kind of leads back into our next question. What international trade policies do you think the U.S. Could use to advance environmental goals for combating climate change?
Well, number one, of course, is stay in the Paris Peace Accords. I mean, the Paris Accords are a critical piece of making sure that the world works together, much like we're seeing President doing an excellent job in Ukraine, getting everyone in the world lined up against the aggressor Putin as he tries to invade a peace-loving country. Same thing has to happen with the Paris Accords. We've got to make sure everyone's on board. We need to have India, China, the rest of the world that, frankly, is as responsible as us or more so now for some of the pollution and climate change effects that we're seeing. It's going to be really important to leverage, I think, our innovation and our technology and spread that around the world. I'm working very hard with a Republican colleague of mine on the only bipartisan bill that would actually help curb climate change. It would dramatically reduce power plant reductions by 95% over the next 15 or 20 years. And with the investments we make in partnership with the private sector, frankly, lead to some great innovations that not only will help the power plants and our transportation sector here, but also really leverage effects across the ocean to our friends and sometimes not our friends overseas so that they can get on board. We made a big down payment on that in the bipartisan infrastructure bill. With my work, I was personally involved in making sure we got that across the finish line. Biggest investment ever in clean energy transmission, biggest investment ever in electric vehicles, biggest investment ever in public transit, according to the President of the United States. And it's really going to help transform the energy picture. Keep up the investments like we've been doing. I've been a big fan of the production tax credits for wind, solar, geothermal, and of course our own hydropower here in the Pacific Northwest. So it's an all hands on deck and all above the approach.
Thank you. The next question, the regulation of firearms remains one of the most polarizing issues in our country today, with gun deaths totaling more than 38,000 per year. What steps do you think Congress should take both to reduce gun violence in the U.S. And stop illegal trafficking of guns to other countries?
Well, we need the Senate to step up and take action on several of the bills that the House of Representatives, with my support, has passed. The time is now for universal background checks. Oregon already has that. We need that, frankly, at the national level. I voted for the Charleston loophole closure that would make sure that a person could not get a gun until that background check is concluded, within at least a 10-day period. So that people that shouldn't be getting firearms shouldn't have them. Also closing the boyfriend loophole. We've done a lot of the great work here in Oregon. I don't see why we can't do that at the national level. People should not be afraid to go to school because of gun violence. Parents, teachers should be feeling comfortable about educating their kids in our public institutions. And this is a serious, serious issue. It needs our full and undivided attention. We could make a huge dent, I think, if we just went ahead and had the Senate approve some of the bills that we've passed in the House.
Terrific. Thank you. Next question. Although each state has the responsibility for running elections, Congress has passed many laws over the years to protect Americans' right to vote. In your view, what is the role of Congress to ensure that voting rights are secure for all?
Well, it's absolutely critical at this juncture. It is extremely alarming to me, and I hope to most Americans, certainly all Oregonians, what is happening in many states across our country, actually restricting access to voting, making it more difficult, more uncomfortable to vote. That just should not happen. That's the reason we passed H.R. 1, the For the People bill, in the United States House of Representatives. The goal being to make sure that elections are full and transparent. Everyone has access, the maximum opportunity to vote, including vote by mail. We made sure our delegation, myself included, made sure that got in the bill as a clear option. Trying to get after campaign finance reform. I sponsor a bill every Congress as an amendment to the Constitution to get rid of Citizens United that has frankly distorted the ability of dark money and billionaires and millionaires to spend lots of money in these races that shouldn't actually happen. And then also deal with redistricting. I think at this point in time, with the gerrymandering that goes on, creates very unequal districts. The best district is a district like the Congressional District Number 5, our district, which has roughly equal numbers of Democrats, non-affiliated, and Republicans. That way, the candidate has to listen to all sides. You can't just live in a little echo chamber and get a distorted view of what's best for the country as a whole. On top of that, I'm very concerned with some states that have a history of restricting access to voting and extreme gerrymandering. So the John Lewis Act needs to be passed. We passed that on the House side. Senate should be picking that up. There's an indication that there is some support on the United States Senate for that legislation. So I think that those are two big efforts that we've done in the House. I've supported big time that hopefully the Senate picks it up. Could level the playing field, make sure everyone as equal access to the ballot.
Thank you so much. Well, time flies. In closing, what else would you like voters to know about you?
I'm a pretty solid Democrat, very socially progressive folks, but fiscally responsible. Got 100% rating with NARAL and the Planned Parenthood group, and I have 100% rating with the Council on Equal and Human Rights. Got 100% rating from Vote Climate PAC. Got 100% rating from Clean Water Action. A rating from the National Education Association. A rating from and Citizens United, as I alluded to earlier. I've lived in the district for 45 years. I've had some big accomplishments bringing the NOAA fleet from Seattle all the way down to little town in Newport to reinvigorate that economy, get jetties to maintain safety in Tillamook Bay, building a Woodburn interchange to allow commerce and safe travel up and down I-5, getting the Willamette locks taken care of, and frankly, getting wildfire hopefully addressed in a much more major way, not just in the infrastructure bill, but in work I've done with Senator Wyden. So if you want someone that knows the district extremely well, has lived here for 45 years, represented the district well, shown himself to be effective, and actually can get elected in November, I hope everyone decides to vote for Kurt Schrader for Congressional District Number 5.
Thank you, Kurt, for talking to us today. We sure appreciate it. And voters, don't forget to check out vote411.org for more ballot and candidate information. Thank you so much.